Hey, church. How's it going? Everybody move their clocks forward? Nope. Yep. Nobody's here yet. Yep. Everybody's filing in. Just figured that clock thing out about 45 minutes ago. Good job, everybody. Hey, I'm going to tell a joke this morning. It's been about a year since I've been doing the announcements, and I've kept away from the jokes. But this morning, you're going to get a couple, so you can thank me later. So here we go. Ready?
Ready.
Two people are ready. Okay, good. So a teacher asked the children in her Sunday school class, if I sold my house and my car, had a big garage sale, and gave all my money to the church, would I get into heaven? No, the children all answered. If I clean the church every day, mowed the yard, and kept everything neat and tidy, would I get into heaven? Again, the answer was, no! Well, she continued, then how can I get into heaven? In the back of the room, a five-year-old boy shouted out, you gotta be dead! I like that. That's a good one. Kids say the darndest things, right? We made a TV show out of that one time. So I've got one more for you guys. And I can't do an Irish accent, so it's going to be a little bit of a Scottish accent. But Father O'Malley answers the phone. Hello. Is this Father O'Malley? It is. This is the IRS. Can you help us? I can. Do you know a Ted Houlihan? I do. Is he a member of your congregation? He is. Did he donate $10,000 to the church? He will. So, hey, welcome to Mountain Church. If you're new here, you're in great company. You're in the right spot. We are a congregation of sinners saved by God's amazing unearned grace. And so you're in good company this morning. Let's all stand, shall we? And let's pray together this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this sanctuary, this meeting place, this place of refuge, this hospital for the soul. We thank you that we can be free to meet here and gather and take in your word, learn of you, just how good of a father you really, really are. And so again this morning, we posture ourselves, we take our knee, and we say, you are Lord and we are not. And we trust you, and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, so I'm going to tell you guys about what's coming up here at Mountain Church. We've got the tribe meeting this evening, and they meet Sunday at the Annex, which is a couple blocks down on Main Street there. And if you don't know what the tribe is, check it out. It's a group of 18 to 30-year-old individuals, kind of that millennial generation, learning how to navigate this crazy world. Together as they look to the Word, look to our Lord, and fellowship together. And a lot of times they have pizza. So if you're a hungry millennial, go ahead and check that out. Check out Facebook for more details on that. Also, this evening we've got Safe Families. It's going to be a follow-up meeting on the previous meeting. A lot of good information last time, a lot of activity with this. And so see Facebook for more details on that. And Chelsea, who is running that, is also at the front desk. You saw her as you were coming in, but she'll also be there as we're leaving. So if you've got questions on that for more details, see Chelsea at the front desk after service. And last but not least, we've got Love and Respect offered again April 5th and 6th. It is a marriage strengthening seminar. It is a relationship strengthening seminar. If you were here Thursday heard me teach and I shared a little bit of my story then, if you missed that, go check out the website mtnchurch.tv and you can see all of our teachings on there, including Thursday. But if you were here, you heard me talk about love and respect and how much of an impact it's had on my life, bringing my marriage back 11 years ago from the brink. And I cannot recommend this highly enough. And that's going to be April 5th and 6th. You guys need to get signed up for it if you are married, if you are planning to get married, or if you think you might get married sometime in the near or distant future. Basically, if you're a human, you need to take this class in. So get signed up for that April 5th and 6th. Love and respect. Don't miss it. And as always, go to mtnchurch.tv and check out our Facebook for more details. So now, as we get ready to worship the Lord, I'm going to give you guys 2 full minutes to say hi to one another. So there's going to be like time for hi, how are you, how was your week? And you may even talk to more than one person before we start worshiping the Lord. So ready, set, go.
All right. That's a good job. You guys did a good job. You greeted for 30 seconds and then started us for a minute and a half. It's good to be in the house of the Lord, and we have opportunity to worship God together this morning. So let's do that.
Quiet, oh God, you're near. song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever be. We live for you, Jesus. Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one that could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Every song. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, Jesus. Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one that could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you.
Lord, it's why we rally here together as your people, Lord, to praise you, to worship, to do what we were created to do, Lord, to acknowledge that you're God, you're our creator, our redeemer, our savior, our friend. And Lord, it's how you made us. It's part of our DNA to cry out and to give you praise. For everything was created by you and for your pleasure. And so you be honored, Lord, we pray. You be blessed as we look to you, as we worship you in the songs that we sing, as we worship you in the reading of your word, responding to your word. Lord, we pray that as your spirit speaks, Lord, that we would listen and act, and Lord, that we would be reduced to love, that our lives would be simplified today, that we would cut anything, Lord, that would keep us from loving you and loving each other, because everything is summed up in that. And so we want to be a people that love unconditionally. And so, Lord, we trust that you're going to do that work in shaping us this morning. We want to hear what you want to say to us, and we want to respond to that. So you be honored, you be blessed now, Lord, as we worship you in your word this morning, in Jesus' name. Everybody said?
Amen.
Amen. You guys can have a seat. It's good to see you this morning. Glad you're here. You lost an hour of sleep, but it is 11 o'clock, so, you know. Glad you're here, and if you're new here, we welcome you. Glad you're here this morning, and on the weekends, we're just going through the Word, and we're presently in the book of 2 Peter, and so if you've got your Bibles with you, turn to the book of 2 Peter, and if you don't have a Bible with you, you can open up a Bible app on one of your devices and turn to 2 Peter. If you have neither of those and you want a Bible to follow along, but also to take home with you and read, just lift your hand. We'll run one down to you right now. So a couple down here, and anybody need a Bible, just lift your hand and we'll run those to you. And so we're in 2 Peter chapter 1, and Peter's writing this letter, as you guys know, if you've been tracking with us. He's writing a letter to an audience of churches that are all dispersed throughout Asia Minor. And the reason they're dispersed out there is because they're kind of on the run. They're on the run because there's massive persecution taking place here in the first century. Under the hand of a ruler by the name of Nero. And Christians were being killed and persecuted. Martyrdom was ramping up big time towards Christians. And so a lot of these Christians that were in these churches that were, you know, dispersed throughout Asia Minor, they had friends or family or you know, loved ones that probably had been killed because of their faith. And so they were kind of on the run a little bit, but God will always use that to spread the gospel. It's kind of cool how that works out. And so Peter writes this letter to them to encourage them. And he writes this second letter to them to really, you know, solidify, hey, guys, don't forget, at the end of the day, I know you're going through hard stuff, and there's a lot of trauma in life, and there's a lot of difficulty in life, and I think all of us could say amen to that. You know, it's just part of the journey. He writes this second letter, and he kind of kicks it off by saying, don't forget the greatest promises in the Word. He calls them precious promises. He said, don't forget the promises that we are destined for heaven, that we're passing through. And yeah, life's hard, no doubt. And nobody dodges that. No matter your economic status, no matter what family you came from, no matter how dysfunctional things may be or not be, doesn't matter what, you know, where you grew up or what your race or what your language or life's just hard. Life, we just have hard stuff in life. And nobody gets out of that. But at the end of the day, if we have faith in the finished work of the cross and what Christ has done for us, if we believe, not predicated on our performance, if we believe in what Christ has done, we are destined for eternity. And Peter writes this letter to exhort the church, saying, listen, don't forget about the precious promise of heaven. We need not be so focused on that that we forget about our mission here, but don't forget, we're destined for heaven. And we're just passing through. And so he says, in light of that, he says in verse 12, therefore. And when you're ever reading the Bible and you run into that word therefore, you got to stop and ask the question, what's it there for? In other words, go back and find the context. And the context that Peter is writing is promises of God. We're destined for heaven. And because of that, verse 12, Peter says, I will always remind you about these things. Even though you already know them and are standing firm in the truth that you've been taught. And it's only right, verse 13, that I should keep on reminding you as long as I live. And Peter, this great apostle of God, he's saying, as long as I live, as long as I have breath in my lungs, I'm going to remind you of what you already know. Your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And we're ultimately going to be in the presence of God. And Peter is saying this knowing that he's only got a short amount of time to live. We're going to continue on in this chapter and find out that Peter knew somehow the Lord had revealed to him his life is coming to an end. He's only in his mid to late 60s, but he knows somehow that his life's coming to an end, whether it's been threats from the government, whatever it might be, I don't know exactly, nobody does, but God had revealed to him, your life is coming to an end. And Peter's writing this letter and saying, you know what? At the end of my days, as long as I have breath in my lungs, I'm going to remind you of what you already know. And that is, you're heading for heaven. And sure enough, Peter would, in the next year after writing this letter, he would die a martyr's death. And he would be killed by the hands of that brutal dictator, Nero. And Peter writes this with incredible passion because Peter understood what redemption felt like. He understood, man, I have gone through a really hard life and I've blown it really bad along the journey. And it's been a rough road, but at the end of the day, I know that my Savior has reconciled me and he has redeamed me. And I am laying hold of that, and I'm gonna play that string on my guitar until the day I die. See, Peter's story is my story. Peter's story is your story. It's our story. Peter's journey from birth to death is our story. And it involves risk. It involves a big mouth. It involves failures and denials and depressions and despair. Peter's story involves restoration. It involves victory. It's our story. It's a story of grace. It's a story of love. It's a story of friendship. It's a story of laughter and tears. It's a story of really the gamut of human emotion. It's our story, Peter's story. Peter was a fisherman. Pretty rough around the edges, those fishermen. And he lived in a commercial fishing climate on the Sea of Galilee. And he's out doing his thing, casting his nets. And along comes this man of Galilee, the Messiah, and calls Peter out and says, Peter, you come and follow me. And Peter, in his eccentric, spontaneous personality, says, okay. And he drops his career. He drops his nets. He drops it all. He says, I'm going to follow this Christ. There's something about him. I don't understand it fully, but I'm going to follow after him. And he would follow Jesus. And Jesus would tell him, Peter, you're a fisherman. And I'm going to make you a fisher of men. You're going to change your whole approach to life. You're no longer going to be fishing in the sea. Man, you're going to be fishing in humanity. And I'm going to make you a fisher of men. Peter was a man that took massive risks. And with massive risks, oftentimes massive payoff can come with those massive risks. And he was a man of risk. And he would have great successes in his life. And he would have great failures also. Peter dropped his net, followed Jesus along his journey with Christ. He took a huge risk in stepping out of a boat at one point and walked on water. I mean, what an incredible story to be able to tell your kids and grandkids. I don't know if you've done any water walking lately, but I'm sure if you've attempted it quite positively, you failed at it. But not Peter. He had great successes. He was there on the Mount of Transfiguration when he saw Jesus literally transformed into glory before his eyes with Moses and Elijah. He heard the very voice of God, the voice of Yahweh speaking. He heard that with his own ears speaking, "This is my beloved Son, hear ye him." So Peter had these incredible successes in his journey. One of his downfalls was his big mouth. Maybe you can start relating to him a little bit. I don't know, I can, you know. It's our story. But Peter had this big mouth, and with that big mouth, he was able to make some incredibly glorious proclamations. One time he opened his mouth, and he made this proclamation. "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And that was such a massive proclamation that Jesus would say, "Peter, it's upon that proclamation that I am going to build my church." That is the whole foundation of everything right there, Peter. Good for you. Good on you. Now, I know the Father in heaven has you know, revealed that to you, but you spoke it out. Good for you, Peter. Man, you used your big mouth for big things, and that's awesome. But Peter would also use his big mouth for incredibly stupid proclamations. Maybe you're starting to feel the story a little more personally now. Jesus would tell the disciples at one point, "Hey, you know, guys, time's come, and I'm going to die, but I'm going to rise again in 3 days." And Peter would literally rebuke Jesus for saying that. Peter rebuked God. Okay, massive mistake. Don't want to rebuke God, by the way. But he rebukes God. He said, "Hey, that's not going to happen. You're not going to die. There's no way that's going to happen." And after Jesus had told him, "You're a rock, man. That proclamation is rock solid. I'm going to build my church on that. I'm going to change your name from Simon to Peter. You're a rock." And just almost in the same breath, Peter would say this stupid proclamation. And Jesus would say, "Get behind me, Satan." So rock one moment, Satan the next. Saying great things one moment, saying stupid things the next. This is Peter's life. It's our life. It's my life. Peter was a living controversy. Some would call that hypocrite. I would say it this way: human. Human. Wanting to do the right thing and then failing in it. But a warrior, a man of God, a disciple, a woman of God will get up and keep doing it, saying, I'm gonna keep moving forward. But he was this living controversy. And at one point he would tell Jesus, "You know, Jesus," in his pride, I believe, Peter said, "You know, all these guys that we're hanging out with here, all these other disciples, they may deny you at some point, but I will never deny you. Because see, I'm Peter, I'm the man, I'm the rock. I've got self-reliant strength. I am strong. I will never let you down. I will never deny you, Lord." Even though these guys might, and Jesus looked to Peter and said, "Peter, you know what? Before the rooster crows tomorrow morning, you're going to deny me three times. No way. Ain't going to happen. Not going to happen. And Jesus would be arrested that evening. Peter would run. And he would be around this campfire. And in the flicker of that light, there would be a little servant girl. They would recognize him as one of the disciples of Jesus and ask him, "Hey, aren't you one of the disciples of Jesus?" And Peter would be like, "What? Huh? What, me? Huh? I don't know. I don't know what you're talking about. No? Uh-uh." And a second time he would be asked, "Wait a minute. No, I recognize you." And your speech kind of gives you away. You're a Galilean. You're a disciple of Jesus. He's like, "No, I don't even know him." And a third time, he would be questioned concerning his, you know, connection with Jesus. And this time, he would say in a very colorful and graphic way, as only a salty old fisherman could, with very graphic language, he would say, "No, I am not a follower of that man." And the rooster would crow. And Peter was crushed. From that moment, Peter was crushed. He ran away. He wept. "I am such an epic fail. I am such an epic loser. My confidence in myself has been killed. I don't even know who I am. I don't even know what I'm capable of. I swore up and down I would never do this. And man, in one night, all that went out the window. My self-reliance is gone." And this would forever change him, this terrible, awesome event of crushing and an awareness of his need to be reconciled, his need for forgiveness, his need for the strength of the Spirit of God within him. He could no longer live in his own pride, and he was now desperate for forgiveness. "I broke my relationship with Christ. I broke my faithfulness to him. I got to be restored. I got to find him. I got to somehow track him down and make things right." But then the unthinkable happened. Jesus died that night. And now Peter was in an incredibly painful position. Heavy with guilt, heavy with condemnation, wanting restoration with Christ, but Christ was dead. It was over. It was done. He was going to have to live with this pain and live with this grief that he was experiencing, this fear and this shame. And so he ran and he wept. I wonder if he thought, "Maybe I'll just do what Judas did when Judas betrayed Jesus." Judas went out and hung himself. "Maybe I'll just end it. I can't live with this shame. I can't live with this fear. I can't live with this grief." And then 3 days later, 3 days after that event, where Peter is just living in this deep, dark, painful place, Peter and John and most of the other disciples were hiding away for fear that they too were going to be crucified. They were followers of, they were disciples of Jesus. And if they did that to him, certainly they'll do that to us. And so they were hiding away for fear of their own crucifixion. And that's when Mary Magdalene, who had gone to the tomb with Mary, the mother of James and Jesus, and Salome, they had gone to the tomb that morning to prepare the body, to put spices upon the body of Christ that had been placed in that sepulcher by Joseph of Arimathea. And as they went down there, Mary had seen this angel when they went down wondering who was going to roll the stone away. And they got there and the stone had been rolled away. And so Mary has this encounter with this angel. And the angel says, listen, I want you to go, for Jesus whom you are seeking is not here. He is risen. I want you to go and tell the disciples and Peter that Jesus is risen. Now, Peter would have been included in the disciples. But specifically, God, through this angel, spoke to Mary Magdalene and told her, go and tell the disciples and Peter, because Peter is in a dark spot. Peter is hurting. Peter is suffering. Peter denied me. Peter's on the run. Peter's suicidal. He is completely beside himself. He is broken. Tell Peter that the story isn't over. Tell Peter that he's not going to have to live eternally in that shame and in that guilt, because Peter was still in this incredible pain. And so Mary goes and tells. And when she does, Peter and John began running down to the garden to go see for themselves. John says that me and Peter ran down to the garden. Peter ran behind the one that Jesus loves, and I beat him there. I love how Peter, or John puts that. The one that Jesus loved outran Peter and got to the tomb first. That's John's account of what happened with John and Peter. But they get there, and Peter somehow pushes John aside and gets into the tomb first, and he looks inside, and Jesus isn't there. And Peter's confused. He's trying to find him. He wants to reconcile. He wants to be restored. He had blown it so bad. He's hurting. He wants to see this relationship right. But Jesus isn't there. And so John and Peter left the tomb and left the garden. And as they left the garden, Mary lingered and she wept in sorrow. And while she was there, she begins to talk with what she thought was the gardener. And the gardener begins to tell her things and talk with her. And as she's having this conversation with the gardener, she realizes it's not the gardener, it's the Christ. It's the resurrected Christ. It's Jesus. And she begins to hug him and hold him. And he kind of pushes her away and said, Mary, not now. But Mary, I'm alive. And he would appear then to the disciples who once again were hiding away a second time. He would appear now to the disciples after resurrecting and after being talking to Mary. Now a second time he encounters humanity and he's there and he comes through this locked door in his glorified state. And he comes into the presence of the disciples and they're all like, whoa. Thomas wasn't there at the time, but all the other guys were, and they're talking, and Jesus fills them with the Holy Spirit. He breathes into them. He gives them peace, and they're just blown out, like, what? What is going on? You're dead, and now you're alive, and and he tells them, you know, I'm going to meet you down in Galilee, and he leaves. Peter's still in this pain. Didn't get a chance to one-on-one it with Jesus. Didn't get a chance to make things right. And he's still feeling that tension. And he's still feeling that grief. And he's still feeling that sorrow and that guilt and all of that. And so they go down to Galilee where they're going to meet with Jesus. And they're waiting. He's going to appear again. We're going to see him again. He said we're going to see him again. We're going to be there. And so they're waiting in Galilee, and they're just kind of, you know, patiently trying to, you know, what's going on? When's he going to show up? What is going on? He's alive, and I thought he was dead. And well, maybe he didn't really die. And they're going through all of the scenarios, you know, and they really don't quite understand what really went place. They don't have the book of Romans yet that explains the doctrine and the theology concerning the atonement. They don't understand that Jesus absorbed the sin of the world upon himself and that the wrath of God was poured out upon the person of Christ for our sin. He became our replacement, our substitute. They don't get all that yet. They're trying to put all the pieces together. And he talked about this, but it was kind of vague and they didn't understand. So they're in Galilee, and Peter, of course it was Peter. He finally gets impatient. Or maybe he's thinking, you know, maybe Jesus isn't going to show up. I don't know why he would. I'm such a loser and a failure. And so he decides, I'm just going fishing. I'm just going to go fishing. A couple of you guys want to come with me? And a couple of the guys joined him, and John was one of them. And they went out to the sea, they pulled the boat off the dock, and off they went. And all night, they're casting their nets. Peter has returned to that which is familiar, that which is a temporary comfort. He's gone back to his old life, back to his past. Is this starting to feel similar or familiar to any of us? It is me. And he's casting his nets all night, nothing. Not a fish, not a squid, nothing. And early in the morning, the next morning, he and the guys hear this man yelling at them from the beach. They're over 100 yards out, the word says. And this guy's yelling at them, "Hey guys, friends!" And they're like, "Are you guys catching anything?" Zero, nothing. "Throw your nets on the other side." Peter's like, "That's weird. I heard that like 3 years ago. But then it was Jesus telling us that." And well, it was Jesus telling us that. And there was like great success. It's weird anyway, that was weird. But so they do. They cast their nets on the other side. And when they do, the net fills up so much with fish as they're trying to reel it in. It's tearing the net. And so they decide, we got to just get this thing to shore. And let's just drag this net. We don't want to lose the fish, so let's go to shore. And as they're making their way to shore, John begins to look closer to that guy on the beach that's been yelling at him. And he finally recognizes, oh my gosh, it's the Lord. And when John says it's the Lord, Peter's like, what? Ah! And he grabs his jacket and he just jumps in the lake. And he's just swimming to shore. He's like, that's, and he wants so desperately to be reconciled, to be restored, to be forgiven, to be healed. He's desperate for that relationship to be restored. And he gets to the fire that Jesus had built there. And Jesus was making some flatbread there on the fire that he could probably just start by, you know, just start it. And he's there. And Peter comes to him after getting out of the water. And he's dripping wet. He's holding his coat. And maybe for the first time in Peter's life, he didn't know what to say. And he's just standing there. And Jesus says, "Peter, why don't you go get some fish and we'll have breakfast here?" And so Peter's like, okay. And he goes over to the net with the other guys that had gotten to shore, and they take a couple fish out of the net, and all of them go back, and they have a really strange breakfast. It's really quiet. We don't, nothing, as far as what's recorded, nothing really happens there. It's kind of quiet. And they're having, and I can understand that. They're like, is he a ghost? He was you know, and I mean, what do you say? Maybe scared. Maybe, I don't know what they were feeling, but it was really quiet, and they're eating breakfast, and still to this day in Israel, fish is a very common breakfast. And if you ever go there and stay in any of the kibbutz, it's always fish for breakfast. And finally, Jesus breaks the silence. And who does he talk to? He talks to Peter. He says, "Hey, Peter, do you love me?" And Peter's like, "This is a setup. Because if I tell you that I love you, then I have totally taken the bait. Because I'll tell you I love you, and then you're going to say, 'So if you love me, will you explain to me why you denied me?'" And Peter's like, "It is Jesus. I'll take the bait." And so he says, "Yeah, I love you." And Jesus probably nods at him. And then Jesus says again, "Do you love me?" And Peter's like, "Oh, man. I am totally digging a hole. But yes, Lord, I do love you. I do love you. And I know I'm guilty. I know I've failed. You're setting me up for a massive, massive beatdown. But yeah, Lord, I love you." And then Jesus said a third time, "Peter, do you love me?" And using different terminology, but still saying, "I love you," but even with a greater passion. "Yes, Lord, I love you." And now probably bracing himself for what is going to be a massive smackdown verbally. Jesus says the unthinkable. He says to Peter, "Then Peter, feed my sheep." What? "Yeah, feed my sheep, Peter. You mean I haven't lost my disciple credentials? I haven't lost my position? You don't hate me for what I've done? You're not going to give me the third degree and tell me that I am no longer a disciple of Jesus? I'm no longer an apostle? You mean to tell me that I'm forgiven? I'm forgiven? You're not mad at me? That I'm restored? That our relationship is okay? You're telling me to go feed my sheep? Jesus hunts down and calls out and reaches out to this wounded, hurting, bleeding child of God who's gone through the worst season of his life. And he pronounces forgiveness. "Peter, feed my sheep. You're forgiven. I'm not mad at you. I'm not angry with you. I'm not, a matter of fact, I'm all about restoration. I'm all about bringing you back in, man. I'm not throwing you under the bus. I'm not putting you on the shelf. I'm desiring to restore you." And Peter, you need to continue in your calling of being my disciple. And in that moment, Peter did what is very unthinkable for Peter, and that is, again, he didn't know what to say. He didn't speak. He's like, and Jesus, see, in this story, wants to teach us many things, but the main thing is that he's all about reconciliation. He's all about forgiveness. The cross of Jesus is all about restoring us, pulling us in, not condemning us, but saying, feed my sheep, do the work. I love you. It's why I came, Peter. And Peter would later understand that the reason that Christ came is because of us. Because he loves us, because he wants to restore us, because he wants to heal us. He's all about redemption. He's all about grace. Undeserved, unearned, unmerited favor with Jesus. And that's what he's all about. And I love this story. I love this story. Because it's our story. We all fall. We all fail. We all deny along the journey. We all blow it really bad. But in time, Jesus hunts us down by his Spirit and reveals his grace to us, that we're loved, that he's not mad at us. And Peter, in time, after this experience, after understanding, I'm forgiven. I can be restored. After this moment, Peter would go on and be the rock that God spoke into his life. Matter of fact, Jesus changed his name from Simon to Peter. Peter means rock. That's how Jesus saw him. You're a rock, man. You're a leader. You're the man, Peter. You're going to be a great man. You're going to go down in history. And Peter, after understanding that he can no longer rely on himself, but that Christ has done all the work and he's loved, after that, oh man, Peter would leave that moment. And but a few days later, he would be in Jerusalem in the upper room where Jesus told the disciples to wait, and the Holy Spirit came upon him and empowered him. And now Peter would be this rock, and he would go out and he would preach that day to thousands, and 3,000 people got saved there in Jerusalem. Peter would be that rock. He would go to Jerusalem. He would preach. There would be thousands saved. And then he would become the pastor of those thousands of people that God saved. Many would go back to their homeland, but he would be the pastor there in Jerusalem for many years. And he would lead, and he would encourage. And it wasn't just dry doctrine or dry theology. It was experiential. It was incarnational. It was life. Peter was speaking from experience. He was madly in love with Christ, whom had reconciled him and restored him. Peter would go on and endure massive persecution, even unto death, and he would do it with joy. He would do it gladly. And he writes this encouraging letter that would become, as we know, God's very word, inspired by God to the church in 1 and 2 Peter. And he would go on and die a crucifixion just like Christ. And the historians would tell us that as he was being crucified and pinned to a cross, he would say in humility and love for his Savior, "Don't crucify me like Christ. I'm not worthy to be crucified like him. Crucify me upside down." And the historians would tell us that that's exactly how Peter died. See, everything changed when he encountered restoration. When he encountered healing. And everybody needs forgiveness. Everybody needs restoration. Everybody, you need it, I need it. Because we may walk with the Lord for years and still live in shame. Peter did. We may walk, we may know the Lord and have been walking with him for years and still live in pride. But there comes a moment of brokenness in our life, which becomes the worst, best moment of our life. It's the moment that we shake off our pride and say, Lord, you know what's best. I am never going fishing again. Metaphorically, I am going to always be the fisher of men that you've called me to be. I am not going back. I'm going forward. And Peter lived that way for the rest of his life. And it was all predicated upon reconciliation. God is not mad at you. Certainly, there are many people mad at you, but God is not one of them. He came to reconcile. And we need it. Everybody needs it. Leadership needs it. Pastors need it. One of our leaders in the church, Jesse Edwards, needs it, as I do. Jesse, many of you guys know Jesse. He's a good friend. He's a faithful brother. He's been serving with me here in the ministry for many years. He was baptized at one of our Easter services years ago, and he's been serving on staff for several years now. And in recent months, Jesse's been through some really deep personal valleys. And while he's been walking through these valleys, and I bring this up because we're a family. And I bring this up because anything that involves leadership involves all of us. And so here at Mountain, we meet things head on and look to the Word and how to navigate. End of story. The Word of God is the final word. And so as Jesse, my friend and my brother, has been walking through a deep valley, he temporarily went back to fishing. And he made some really bad decisions and began to gamble away his money. And because of this, he dug a significantly deep debt. And a gambling addiction is a very deadly addiction because it always leads to other things when you start getting in the hole. And so I was made aware of that in a conversation with him months ago. And so the elders and myself, we rallied around him, laid hands on him, prayed for him, and said, Jesse, we are going to walk with you. This was before it got into a really bad situation. We're going to walk with you. We're going to help you. We're going to journey with you. We're going to stay close touch with you. And we have. And we will continue to. But along that journey, this last week, it became apparent to myself that I needed to let him go. And these are hard decisions because it affects all of us. And in plurality with the leadership, decided, yeah, we have to. Because he has an addiction. And he can't get recovery from an addiction and be a leader in the church simultaneously when it's gotten to this degree. And he is totally repentant. And totally loved and totally forgiven. And our role as a church family, and we are a family here. Oh, by the way, if you're visiting, we're having a little family meeting right now. So, but this is how we roll. And as a family, our role is to see him restored. To see him healed. Our role is to see him healthy. That's our role. And in time, Jesse will, like Peter, be reinstated into his work in ministry. Now, I don't know how that's going to happen. I don't know when that's going to happen. I don't know where that's going to happen. But I know it's going to happen because God's word says that will happen. Why? Because it says that the gifts and the callings of God that he has put in our life are without repentance. In other words, God does not give us gifts and then take them away from us. And Jesse is one of the most gifted guys I know. He's a talented, gifted, funny, great. I don't think I've laughed more with any individual maybe in my lifetime. I just love him, which makes the decision all the more difficult. But he will be restored. And Jesse has told me and he's told us that he will continue to be a part of our family. He's not going to cut and run. He's going to be a part of our family. And it's humiliating. He's humiliated. He feels ashamed. He feels condemned. And I have reassured him, Jesse, there is no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. You do not have to live in shame. You are loved. And this has not changed anything as far as relationship. Changes some things, you know, as far as your vocation presently, but it doesn't change relationship. And so when you see him, if you know him, when you see him, you love him. When you see him, you encourage him. When you see him, you forgive him. When you see him, don't loan him any money. When you see him, just love him. He's our brother. He wrote this letter to you, and he wants me to read it. He did this voluntarily. I didn't ask him to do this. But here's what he says. Dear family, I ask that you all would forgive me, for I have sinned against you. In my financial desperation after a broken marriage, I foolishly and selfishly began to gamble a lot. And I've allowed that sin to lie to me to the point of financially putting my family into a hole and disqualify me from a pastoral position at Mountain Church. I've misrepresented our Savior. I've forsaken your trust. And again, I ask that you please forgive me. And as some of you know, I've been struggling with focusing on the task at hand. And when you add sin to that struggle, the byproduct is a staff that has to bear the load of a fool. And I am so very sorry. My heart breaks repeatedly at the thought of what I've allowed to happen. And I didn't disclose my gambling problem to Jim when I had the chance. But in his scary, gracious, loving leadership, he helped shine the light on my epic failure as a leader and as your brother. So please forgive me. I love you all so very much. I look forward to seeing you soon, but first I need to let the Spirit pull the roots of the seed I let grow in my heart. And I'd be a liar if I said I'm in good spirits, because I'm not. I'm in all-out war, and my flesh wants to give in. But he who is in me is greater than he who is in the world, and I'm hopeful that I will taste the victory that is already mine to have. And I have victory in Christ, my friends. But please pray that I accept that truth and walk it out. And I'll talk with you all soon. Sincerely, Jesse. That's Jesse. That's the Jesse, yeah. Yeah. That's Jesse. That's the guy we all love and And that's the guy that God is going to restore. Jesse has a calling on his life. I've known it for years. And Jesse, I believe, will be planting a church someday. This is part of the process. Because you can't ever pastor a church and lean on your own strength. It's everything to pastor a church and lean into Christ and survive even that. And this is part of the process for Jesse. And I believe that. And that hasn't changed. And yeah, it's hard, and yeah, it's humiliating, but humility is one of the worst, best things that can happen in our life. And forgiveness and restoration is the air we breathe. We have to have that. And that's who Jesus is. And that is what we do. And I thank God that I've had people in my life that have extended chance upon chance to me, that have restored me, that have loved me when I justifiably should have been put on the shelf or justifiably should have been thrown under the bus. I've had people in my life over the years that have shown me grace. I'm very Peter-like. And I'm so glad that Jesus forgives and he restores. And let the same be said of his people. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you loved us enough, even when we were running from you, even when we were denying you, even when we had gone back to our old ways, you sought us out and you called out to us and you drew us in by the warmth of your fire. And you pronounce forgiveness. And so, Lord, we pray for our brother Jesse and his family, his parents, his kids, siblings. Lord, we pray blessing on him. And pray, Lord, that you would restore. And we know you will. And you've restored us. And we come to your table knowing that we are a people of hope, that we are a people that are forgiven, that we are a people that are healed. And Lord, if we've brought things into this house, Lord, today, sin, bitterness, anger, fear, anxiety, hatred, whatever it is, we just lay it down. We lay it down at the foot of the cross, knowing that we can cast our cares on you because you care for us. And so we come to your table with a clean heart, a heart of repentance, and we celebrate forgiveness. And so you be blessed and worshiped in this way, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to open the tables right now for the receiving of elements of communion. And come and take the elements, and then we'll have communion together. And it's also an opportunity to give. This, if you're a part of the family, if you're visiting, this doesn't apply. But if you're a part of the family here, we worship the Lord in our giving too. And we give the tithe. And we can do that online. Or if we want to do it here, there's boxes available at the tables to give of the tithes and offerings. And then we'll come back together in just a moment, have communion, and we'll continue on. So the tables are open. Please come and take the elements of communion.
The music. All is stripped away, and I simply come. longing just to bring something that's good that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, with the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it, but it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. Of endless words, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours. Every single breath, I'll bring you more than a song. I'll bring you more than a song. For a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it, but it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made, but it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus.
Lord, we thank you for the reconciling work that you've done. Lord, we don't have to live under that weight of guilt and shame. And so, Lord, we bless you. We take this element of bread as you would break bread with your disciples and tell them that it represents your body. Your body was broken so that we could be restored. We could be healed of our shame and healed of our guilt and healed of our failures and our fears and brokenness. And so, Lord, we thank you that we're in right relationship with you. And we respond like Peter. Yes, Lord, we love you. We love you. We love you. And so we take this bread, Lord, in remembrance of you, in Jesus' name. Let's take the bread together. And Lord, we do what you did with your disciples. You drank that wine with them and told them that this is your blood, symbolically. It's the New Testament. That we don't obtain righteousness by any work of the law, by any ceremony or any Sabbath. We don't obtain righteousness by jumping through religious hoops. We obtain righteousness by one way and one way alone, and that is through the blood of Christ, by faith alone. And so we choose faith in Christ. Thank you for being the Lamb of God and you're shedding your blood, justifying us, meeting the demands of perfect justice. And now, Lord, we can have that precious promise of eternity. And so we bless you and love you and take this cup in remembrance of you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Let's take the cup together. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hey, we're going to take just a few moments before we go back into the craziness that lives outside these walls in our lives. And we're just going to pray. We're going to meditate. We're going to worship. We're going to sing some songs. Ryan will dismiss us in a few moments. Don't worry about getting your kids. They're glad to be away from you for a while, the ones that are upstairs. But we're just going to worship. It's a great time to let this stuff settle into our hearts. Because this was not about Peter. It wasn't about Jesse. This was all about Jesus and us. And so let's let that word, let's respond to that. If you need prayer, myself and other pastors will be down front to pray with you. If you need to just stand and surrender and just lift your hands and surrender to the Lord, if you need to kneel down before him in humility, or, I don't know, but let's respond. Let's take a few moments and then we'll be dismissed in just a few minutes.
I look to the cross, I cling. Oh, with suffering I do dream. Oh, it's work I do sing. For only my Savior would bruise and cross. That God is love and God is just. And to cross you, beg you near, draw me gently to my knees, and I'm lost for words, so lost in love.
Gently to my knees, and I'm lost for.
majesty. Let all the earth rejoice. All the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light. Darkness tries to hide. Trembles at his voice. Trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, we'll see how great is our God. Age to age, he stands. Time is in his hand. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The God here, three in one. Father, Spirit, and Son. The Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God. On the way, my foes are many, they rise against me, but I will hold my ground. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm, my help is on the way. My help is on the way. Oh my God, he will not delay. My refuge and strength always. I will not fear. His promise is true. My God will come through always. Always. Surrounds me, chaos abounding. My soul will rest in you. I will not fear the war. I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way. My help is on the way. Oh my God. I will not. His promise is true. My God will come through always, always. Father, you are faithful. You are always righteous and true, full of justice. Coupled that with kindness and mercy and grace overflowing. And so we come before you this day and we praise you, our awesome and mighty and loving and gracious God, our faithful God. Thank you for being long-suffering with us. Thank you for extending grace and mercy to us. Thank you for restoration and healing in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you guys, and we'll see you next week.
Hey, I know that you were totally blessed by the Word because the Word of God is powerful and it changes us. And so I'm really glad you guys tuned in today. And if you want to continue to maybe hear more about the series that we're in, or you want to just check out some of the other teachings, feel free to go to mtnchurch.tv and you can find all of our teachings posted there. But more importantly, man, I hope that you, if you're in the vicinity at all, you can come and join us live. And come to our services. I'd love to meet you and pray with you. So God bless you, and I hope to see you soon.